Today we are marking the 232nd anniversary of Evacuation Day, when the last British troops left New York City and in fact left the colonies after the conclusion of the American Revolution. And it also coincided with our own anniversary, the anniversary of our unit, the Veteran Corps of Artillery of the State of New York, the 9th Field Artillery. We were founded 7 years after Evacuation Day in 1790, just a few blocks away at City Arms Tavern at present-day Broadway and Thames Street. And what caused that to happen was veterans of the American Revolution were very concerned that the New York City was very much still pro-British, and they feared that their newfound won independence was in jeopardy, and they felt compelled to do something.
Successful American Revolution witnessed by General George Washington, that he would later return to Lower Manhattan in 1789 and become the first president of these United States. On that day, April 30th, 1789, after his inauguration as president, President Washington came here to St. Paul's to pray for the success of the new nation. Later in 1789, President Washington issued the very first Thanksgiving proclamation in Lower Manhattan, declaring November 26, 1789, America's first Thanksgiving Day. That day, 226 years ago tomorrow, President Washington returned to St. Paul's Chapel, where we are right now, to pray and to celebrate the first American Thanksgiving Day. We should also be thankful to be here today where the spirit of George Washington dwells, and to celebrate the 225th anniversary of the Veterans Corps of Artillery, State of New York, the 225th anniversary of George Washington's letter, and evacuation. Now I'm proud to introduce Reverend Deacon Zito, Deacon of the Parish of Trinity Wall Street, and Deacon Zito was also an officer in the Veterans Corps of Artillery.
Good morning. My name is Bob Zito, as you just heard, and I have the privilege of serving as the Parish Deacon of Trinity Parish, which also includes this St. Paul's Chapel. I also have the honor of serving as the chaplain of the 9th Field Artillery Regiment, also known as the Veterans Corps of Artillery, which was founded just a few blocks from here at what was once known as the City Arms Tavern on Thames Street and Broadway in the year 1790. On behalf of the rector of Trinity Parish, I welcome you all here today. St. Paul's Chapel was completed in 1766 and is the only real existing example of colonial architecture. It is the oldest running public building in the city of New York. I pray that the spire of St. Paul's Chapel, despite its past and despite all that it has endured, during the time of the Revolution and during 9/11, I pray that the spire of St. Paul will reach towards the heavens for us. Will the congregation please stand? Please present your flags for the blessings. May the Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, we gather together upon the anniversary of the first peace that our country was blessed to receive during its struggle for independence. It is on this day that General George Washington, as commander of the Colonial Army, triumphantly led his regiment into New York to finalize our nation's independence. It is here in this place that General George Washington worshipped after being sworn in as the first president United States of America. Now bless these flags, O Lord, as they are a symbol of our nation and our heritage, and a memorial to all who have made the ultimate sacrifice for duty and honor in the service of our beloved country. Amen. Please.
Ladies and gentlemen, now it's my great honor to introduce Colonel Joseph D. Davis. Colonel Davidson is the commander of Fort Hamilton Garrison in nearby Wilmington. He's a combat veteran and a fabulous speaker, especially about military history. The first time I heard Colonel Davidson speak about military history, I thought I could qualify for a master's degree in history. The details are in your program. The rest you will hear from yourself. Colonel Davidson, please.
All right, that's a nice simple bar, really. All right, thanks, Alan. Distinguished guests, visitors, thank you for joining us here today to reflect on and remember Evacuation Day. Special thanks to the Veterans Corps of Artillery, Colonel Ryan. You guys look great, and it is a great honor to be here with you today. Thank you for the invitation to speak. So, the Continental Army, of course, is long gone. It is up to us to repeat the stories of their campaigns, their suffering, or their triumphs. It is up to us to treasure them in our heart of hearts and to speak their praises to our children so that we may keep unimpaired our love of country and kindle patriotism of those who come after us. Today, they shall live again in the event we celebrate. And what event can be more strongly appealed to the popular gratitude than which brought our city a happy deliverance from a foreign power, gave welcome relief to our patriot sires who had fought for their country or suffered exile, and marked the close of a struggle which conferred the priceless blessings of peace and liberty, and a government which knows no sovereign but the people only. Evacuation Day is really all about resilience. Resilience that started in our American Revolution, and resilience that is still seen here in New York City today. It really starts with General Washington and his personal resilience. Historians will laud Washington for his selection and supervision of his generals, for the preservation in the command of the army, for his coordination with Congress, with the state governors, and the many militia, to the attention he paid to the supplies, the logistics, and the training. But what history also depicts is in battle, Washington was repeatedly outmaneuvered by British generals who were better trained, better equipped, and certainly had larger armies. Washington had to have the resilience to hold on, to press on, when all hope was lost. Now, New York led the way in resilience, but over time, it spread through the rest of the 13 colonies, and eventually the rest of the country as it grew. And America's resilience is still felt today. I'd like to share with you Emma Lazarus' sign, which most of you know a part of. It's called the New Colossal, cries she with silent lips. Give me your tired core, your huddled masses, yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless, tempest-tossed to me. I lift my lamp beside the golden door. Thank you.
Taking the honor today is to introduce Captain Conlon. Captain Conlon is another great speaker. Captain Conlon headed up the Gurkha 6th Regiment in Bordeaux. And unless he's speaking to Belize, there's not much you can find out about that unless you speak with him. Captain Conlon was a protege of David Sterling, founder of SAS, a Britain Special Air Service, fought with all special forces in the world today. Captain Conlon.
I want to discuss the impact of this war on the British Army and the Royal Navy. This was a disastrous event as the soldiers and sailors got into their ships at the bottom of Manhattan and sailed back to England. They were angry, confused, frustrated. Arguably, the British Army was the biggest, best killing machine at that time in the world. The Royal Navy was the finest navy in the world. How was it then that these farmers turned citizen soldiers had been able to defeat the British armed forces? How was it that the French Navy was able to intervene at Yorktown? This brought about tremendous soul-searching back in London. And there was tremendously important developments from that. And I firstly like to talk about the Royal Navy. There was immense corruption in the dockyards, in the financing. There was mayhem in the ship ordering process. Politicos, crony capitalism. It was all swept away. And in 20 years' time, the Royal Navy was able, at the Battle of Trafalgar, to defeat the French and Spanish Navy. So on behalf of the British government, the British population, and the armed forces of Her Majesty, thank you for defeating us in 1783.
Now I'd like to call up Ambassador Lowe. Ambassador Lowe was commissioned out of the Harvard ROTC program and served during the Korean War in the Materiel Command. He was the first lieutenant in the United States Air Force. Ambassador Lowe was a member of the Sons of the American Revolution and an honorary president of the Sons of the Revolution. You can believe we had such a big unit that we needed two organizations. His family has fought in every war in the United States except for Vietnam. Ambassador Lowe was the founder of the George Washington Institute for Religious Freedom and a supporter of the VCA, and he will read the George Washington letter on religious freedom. Ambassador.
About 15 people last year, officially reinstituted the holiday, and I see many more than 15 people here today. So that's not odd. The other thing, the things that we have done is we celebrate the anniversary of the American victories at Saratoga in Yorktown with this ceremony at Trinity Church, where we lay wreaths on the graves of General Gates, who many of you may not know is buried at Trinity Church, and Alexander Hamilton, who was the hero of Yorktown, probably many more of you have heard of, and a man named Aaron Spiller. The other thing that we have done is the first July 4th parade here in Lower Manhattan this year, in 39 years ago, 2015. And as part of our July 4th celebration, we read in its entirety the Newport letter in front of Francis Tavern. So I'm very honored to be here, and I'm honored that the Veteran Corps of Artillery, which was 225 years old, Alan, my co-founder, Arthur Piccolo, Ambassador Loeb, Mrs. Zito, and particularly Trinity Church, which has been a great supporter of Trinity Parish. And hopefully we will move forward with another more extensive flag raising at Bowling Green, and continually and repeated future celebration of Evacuation Day, so that Evacuation Day, which is all called a forgotten holiday in New York for 100 years, will be forgotten no more. Thank you.
And Steve Mann is the Commandant of the Veteran Corps of Artillery State of New York. He has been working diligently to bring the Corps back to its former glory and is succeeding rapidly. There's a lot I can say about this young man, but not enough time to say it. Let me just start with the part that he would never tell you about himself, and you can read the rest of his order. Colonel Ryan has deployed multiple times. He's a combat trained veteran with deployments in Iraq, Afghanistan, Djibouti, and Kenya. His decorations include the Bronze Star, the Defense Meritorious Service Medal, and the New York State Conspicuous Service Medal. Colonel Ryan, please.
Commemorated here in 1962 when Archbishop Terry Michael Ramsey officiated and blessed the church at Newton Allen today. It also should be noted that Evacuation Day used to be a major New York City holiday. The city public schools were closed. Thank you. And I hope you enjoy us.
So now before we depart, we're going to retire the colors, and you will be kind enough to rise. Retire the colors.
Color guard.
National anthem sung by Major DeLeo.
Battery up, tangent. Son of God. Freezing.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleam? Whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the
Commandant Colonel Stephen Ryan will return the British flag to our young British friend here, Captain John Corn. So, Colonel Ryan.
After the American people and citizens of New York, please return this flag. Gratitude and renewed friendship with the people of the British Isles and to our sovereign, Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth.
area, so that it will be called Evacuation Day Plaza, so that more people, our children and other people come by here, will know of the importance of this area, and they will know about Evacuation Day.
And also Community Board one member who passed a resolution to support co-naming this plaza. Exactly 232 years ago today, before all these high-rises you see, congested streets and tourists, a group of Americans gathered right here to see the last British troops and their families off as they depart from the newly minted United States of America, and to welcome the victors of the American Revolution, our General George Washington.
That you see here are wearing the uniform that the United States Army wore during the War of 1812. Although we were founded just after the Revolution, this was the first time the unit was called active duty. But the soldiers in the unit were comprised of veterans of the American Revolution. And a Sergeant John Van Arsdale was the colonial soldier who was able to climb the pole that was greased, remove the flag that was nailed, and throw the Union Jack to the ground. For those of you who were here a little early, we did it a little nicer today because of the close ties we have with Great Britain. Sergeant Van Arsdale went on to become the Vice Commandant, the Deputy Commander of the current unit you see before you in the 1820s.
This is the plaque that commemorates Evacuation Day and the 225th anniversary of the Veteran Corps of Artillery.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'll just read it to you. Evacuation Day. On November 25th, 1783, at 1 p.m., the last British flag flying in the newly independent American states near this site at Fort George was removed by John Van Arsdale, who climbed the flagpole, which had been greased by the British, removed their flag, and replaced it with the Stars and Stripes, formally ending the American Revolution. General George Washington led the ceremonies that historic day. Since that historic occasion, the British have become our strongest ally. This plaque, presented November 25th, 2015, is a gift from the Veteran Corps of Artillery, State of New York, Colonel Ryan Commandant, founded November 25th, 1790, in honor of our 225th anniversary this very day. Captain John Van Arsdale was one of the VCA founders. Thank you.
Thank you, Colonel Ryan.
Right.
Repeat.
Come on. Come on.
Oh,